Hey everyone, in this video I'll be doing a short demo on how to do some basic corpus statistics in R using the Quantida package. So the tutorial that we'll be walking through here, the link for the tutorial is also in the description, so you can actually do every step yourself. In this video we'll just focus on the analysis part. Of course we will need to actually read some data before that, so we will show a bit about how to do this. For this we're going to import data from a CSV file that's hosted online. So for reference here we say, well, we're going to use the readr package. Actually, more typical nowadays is just say we're going to use the tidyverse because this contains readr. Now we have a data frame in R which contains some wells and document variables, and it also contains a column with text. So now we can use this to create a corpus for performing text analysis. This data, by the way, is inaugural speeches from US presidents split by paragraph. To create a corpus, we have just one simple function from the Quantida package. The corpus function, where we just provide the data frame, and then we specify the name of the column which contains the text. So as we saw, the column is named text. Here we specify that the text field is text. And voila, now we have a corpus. And it tells that we have about 23,500 documents, so all paragraphs, and 4 document variables. So the corpus also still contains all that additional document information, such as who the president was, what the time, what year it was, etc. Of course, we're also going to need to create a document term matrix from this. So for this, we'll just use the DFM function from Quantida with some basic standard pre-processing steps. So let's do some stemming. Let's remove some stop words. So again, remove function in Quantida is basically saying just provide a character vector to remove some terms, and the stop words function just simply gives you a list of typical stop words in English. So here we say remove any of these words. Should we do more? Let's also remove some punctuation. Needed. Now we have a document term matrix. You see that we have about, again, the same amount of columns, about 20,000 features, so 20,000 words. Also, good to know is a bit about what all these numbers mean. So here we see 99.8% sparse. And this refers to how sparse the matrix is. In this case, it means that it's 99.8% of all the cells in our document term matrix contains the value 0. This, of course, makes a lot of sense because we have 20,000 unique words that have been used in this corpus, but most documents will only contain a very small portion of all these words. So as an additional pre-processing step, and one that we also do here, I think, it's also then good to remove some of the less frequent words. So this line of code basically says we're going to trim our DFM, we're going to trim it down a bit, and what we're going to do is we're going to specify a minimum number of times that the word needs to occur. So here we say we're going to remove all the terms from our document term matrix that occurred less than 10 times. This is often a good step to do because words that don't occur very often are often less informative. And for some types of text analysis, it's good to not have too many terms. And in this case, you see that we went from about 20,000 unique terms to about 5,000. And now we can skip to the analysis part. So that's step 3 in the tutorial. And actually, once you've created a document term matrix in R, you'll see that most of the analysis part is really simple. Many one lines of codes. It's really conveniently done. Hooray for Quantida. So just copy paste this thing here. So here we just see a function from creating a simple word cloud, which is always fun and sometimes useful. Word clouds are nice because if you're doing a bag of word style analysis anyway, it's good to see what words are common in your data. So here we see that, can I do this more properly? Just have a look around me a bit. So if we just make a word cloud here with 50 words from a DTM, so it automatically will choose the 50 most frequent words. And then we see that, for instance, state and govern, nation, year, Congress are really common words in speeches from US presidents. Now we have some very small variations in code here. So for instance, if you make a word cloud, you can also add a vector for different colors, which will simply create some layering in your word cloud, with the most frequent words being red and the less frequent words being blue. It's really not useful, but it's still quite fun. So word clouds, of course, just refer to term frequencies, and it makes more sense often for an analysis to just look how often these terms actually occurred. So you also see that state was a term that occurred 9,234 times in all these US president speeches. So this is just a very basic start of text analysis. Word clouds can be nice to just get a quick grip of what some texts are about, but it's not really analysis material yet. We're going to do some more stuff here. One thing, for instance, which makes a lot of sense with these types of tools is to just focus down on some specific subsets of the data. For instance, we know that we have speeches from US presidents. So we can also focus our analysis on one specific president, or a selection of presidents, or all Democrats, or all Republicans, what have you. So now we're going to first select some rows in our document term matrix where we know the president was Obama. We can do this quite easily because one of the cool things about Quantida is that whenever you create a document term matrix out of a corpus, as we did in this line of code, using the corpus as the input, it automatically stores all the document variables in the document term matrix as well. So for every row in a document term matrix, we also know who the president was, at what year the speech was given, and such. So here we can say, for all the rows, was the president Barack Obama, true or false? Then we can select all the rows where the president was Obama. And then we can create a separate word plot to just focus on the words that Obama was mainly using. Now, of course, when you look at this kind of stuff, it can tell us a bit about what kind of word Obama uses. But often, it might be more interesting to not look just at the absolute frequencies of these words, but at the relative frequencies. So focus more on what distinguishes Obama from other presidents. And this is what brings us to the part which we here call comparing corpora. It's just a simple kind of, again, a simple kind of word frequency technique. So instead of just looking at specific as absolute word frequencies, we're going to take a subset of a corpus and then see what kind of words are really relatively more frequent in that subset. And it's often a good way to investigate specific aspects of that subset. So here we again just copy paste the code. This line is actually identical to this one. We're just making a vector to say which rows in our DTM are rows where Obama was the author, or the person that gave the speech. And then here we're going to use the text stat keyness function. And by keyness, this is how Quantida calls this corpus comparison thing. And we're going to say from our DTM, we want you to compare all the rows where the president was Obama to all the other rows. And what this gives us is just a simple data frame, which then tells us for a given word, how often it was used by Obama. That's n target. So here we see that the word job was used 203 times by Obama. And the n reference shows how many times it was used by any of the other presidents. So all the remaining rows in our data. So while, of course, 203 is less than 626, this is from all the other presidents combined. So then we want to see how frequently Obama used this word relative to all the other words that he used. And that's basically what you can represent in this chi-square score. So this tells us about the relative frequency in which Obama used the word job, which turns out to be extremely high. So the probability of Obama using the word job is much higher than that of other presidents using it. Well, I shouldn't really say probability, it's an observation. So Obama just used it relatively much more often. We can also look at the other side of this story, so at the tail of the data. Then we can see what words Obama used exceedingly less. So here, for instance, we see that Obama, even though state was one of the most occurring terms, Obama was not one of the people who really used this word that often. It actually has a negative chi-square value here, which of course is impossible, but this just indicates that it's a chi-square value of about 85 in a negative direction. It means it's underrepresented. Obama used the word state relatively less often than the other presidents. And this is a simple but actually pretty cool tool to just get a quick idea of some subset of the data, what distinguishes it, what is typical for it. And we can actually make this a bit more easy to explore by using this text plot keyness function. So notice here how we use the text stat keyness to create the text stat keyness. And then we're going to plug this into the text plot keyness. So making a plot out of text stat data. Let's make this a bit bigger. Is this readable? That should be readable, right? So you see that indeed job, as we saw before, is one of the clear outliers, so to say. So the word that is really overrepresented in the Obama corpus, a word that Obama used relatively much more often than the rest of the corpus, and state is the one which jumps out most to the left. Here you see some other words which Obama was just relatively much more likely to use, and these are words which was relatively less likely to use compared to other presidents. But that's slightly more informative than a word cloud. And it's really easy to run. So that makes it a quite useful technique to just know for some quick exploration of your corpus. Now, we've just been looking at individual words. And that's, of course, one of the general downsides of when we're using these bag of words type analysis, is that we're only looking at frequencies of words and not taking into account in what context these words have been used. So now when you find something like that Obama talks a lot about jobs, one thing that you might want to do is just get a quick overview of in what kind of cases Obama used this. How did he use it? What kind of stories was he telling when he used his words? And a classic way of doing this is with a keyword in context listing, also called KWIC. So keywords in context are, again, something really easy to use. Important to notice here is that we're using the corpus for it, so not the document term matrix, because in the document term matrix, we have dropped all context. We're only looking at word frequencies. And here what we want to do is we want to view the occurrence of a specific word in the context of several words before and after it. So we simply say, given our corpus, we want to look for the word freedom, and then we want to show a window of 7 words to the left and right of this word. I get this. Actually, let's try to make this a bit larger. Window's a bit too large to show it on one line. Yes, this makes it much easier to see. So you can see that the word freedom occurs, and this is the sentence surrounding it. So as far as it consists, with freedom of sentiment, dignity may, the United States is legitimate, freedom, the instructions to, freedom, 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 blah, 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 freedom. So this is a nice way to just get a quick indication of how this word has been used in the corpus. And this is, first of all, a very useful exploration tool because it helps you if you find some interesting word in your analysis, in your word cloud, in some semantic network. It's always good practice to actually see how this word is being used, because it's quite easy to just get off on the wrong foot on human interpretation, seeing a word and thinking, well, of course, he's talking about creating jobs, but it might actually be something entirely different. So you do want to check some of the more important words in your analysis in some keyword and context listing. But there's actually an additional thing which you can do with these keyword and context things, which is, again, one of these cool things which Quantida just tends to hand out for free. And that is that if you have a keyword and context listing, you can quite easily make a new corpus out of this, and hence a new document term matrix. And this is just a simple but very useful tool to have. Here we say, let's make another keyword and context listing from our corpus. We're going to look for every word that starts with the word terror. And I mean, it starts because this asterisk, as in many search languages, means is a wildcard. It can be followed by anything. So this can be terrorist, terrorism, terror, etc. Look forward. Ta-da. Now let's make a corpus out of this, which is really no different from just using the corpus function and then throwing in this keyword and context listing. And then we can again make a document term matrix out of it. So here we plug in the corpus, We do some basic pre-processing again, so in this case, lowercasing it, removing stop words, stemming it, and removing punctuation. So now what we have is a new document term matrix, which only contains words which occurred in a short proximity, a default proximity here, by the way. So here you specify how close it should be to the word terrorism. So I have a document term matrix which just says, gives us all the words that occurred in close proximity of the word terrorism. As a small side note, notice how this is actually a simple, smart way of moving slightly beyond this limitation of the bag of words approach, because it does allow you to, instead of focusing at the entire document level, to just focus a bit more on some specific context. So you want to focus on things, for instance, that surrounding when Trump is mentioned, surrounding when terrorism is mentioned. Just focus a bit more on an actual specific case. So to show this, we can then, for instance, make a word cloud of just this terror DTM, all the words close to terrorism, which would give us this word cloud. So it contains things like fight, war, weapon, country, attack, support, network, terrorist, naturally. And generally speaking, it again is just a normal word cloud, but in this case focusing on, well, the context surrounding terrorism. What kind of words tend to come up when presidents of the United States talked about terrorism or terror in their inaugural speeches? So far we just did some basic explorative stuff. In this tutorial we also have something about dictionary search, but I won't talk about it here because we'll do a separate demo on using dictionaries. Oh, but it actually leaves us with the entire tutorial. So no, let's indeed do a small demo on dictionaries. Now we're going at it anyway. So dictionaries, as mentioned before, are closely tied to the idea of just keyword searches. Often a dictionary is simply, well, a list of words that you want to look for and then assign some kind of value. In the most simple application, this is just if some kind of word occurs, count it as the occurrence of some kind of category. So this, for instance, would be a dictionary where we just define some very simple dictionary terms for finding certain categories of content. So terrorism, we're just going to look for anything that starts with terror, which of course is a bit greedy way of searching it, but it's just a simple example. Say for economy, where we're just going to look for economy, economical, tax, taxing, job, jobs, job markets, all that kind of stuff. Military, again, some basic short list of relevant terms. And freedom, just going to look for freedom and liberty. So this here is just a very simple short dictionary, which, to make the link back to the video on analyzing, is this is really clear deductive type rule-based approach. We as researchers have now very specifically decided that terrorism is measured as anything that starts with the word terror. How valid this is, how accurate this is, we don't know, but this is just a rule that we decided at this point. Now dictionaries, when you apply them in Quantida, there are several ways of doing it, but one of the nice ways of doing it is a form in which it actually creates a new document term matrix. So if you have the DFM lookup function, what we get is we can take the original DTM that we had, so with all the inaugural speeches, then we're going to apply the dictionary on this. And what this does, it gives us a new document term matrix. And in this document term matrix, we only have four features left, namely the ones that we defined in our dictionary. Basically, we went from a document term matrix to what you might say a document dictionary matrix or a document query matrix. In any case, it's instead of looking at the specific terms that are being used, we now have a document term matrix in which the columns represent specific keyword categories that we defined. And the reason why this is nice to mention and why it still sticks in nicely with the corpus statistics focus is that since it's now a DTM, you can again apply all the techniques for analyzing a DTM. So you can still apply the word cloud function, for instance, which in this case would of course not be very interesting, because it just shows that they talk a lot about economy, a little bit about freedom, and then some military and terrorism here, well hidden. Oh, sorry, you can see it. So yeah, this example is ridiculous, but it shows you the general thing, right? If you make a larger dictionary, you can use word clouds. You can also use these relative comparisons. So see whether, if we have some search term, whether Obama talked relatively more or less about terrorism compared to other presidents. So you can do those types of analysis as well. And then as a final closing note on this, recall that we can use the keyword in context function to just look up certain words. And if you're creating dictionaries, it's often good practice to see where you can actually find how these terms in your dictionary are being used in your corpus. So there's one final trick of the keyword in context function. The keyword in context function, as the term that it wants to look for, simply takes a simple query. So it can also take part of a dictionary. So let's say here we have the dictionary, and this dictionary has several dictionary terms. So dict has terrorism, which just refers to our query for terrorism or economy. And we can again plug these dictionary searches into our keyword and context function. So here we say, look in our corpus for all the cases where our query for terrorism occurs. Oh, let's make this somewhat smaller so that we can see it again. More small. Right. So you can see in what context and for what specific words that are matched with terror, we actually match them with our dictionary. So here we see things like terror, the allies of terror, in which case terror indeed just refers to terrorism, the war on terror as well, crowd and fighting terror. So in general, we see that in this data, the word terror as a search term for terrorism isn't that bad at all, even though the word terror can of course be used in other ways than terrorism as well. And you can do this with any of the terms, of course, in a dictionary. Economy, taxes, economizing, and some of the words around it. So that's just in a nutshell is some of the cool stuff that you can do. I mean, Quantita is a really nice suite for working with this kind of stuff. It just really helps for simply exploring some cool stuff about your corpus. And the combination of these functions just makes for a very nice toolkit to get a basic exploration going about your corpus, to see what it's all about, to make some comparisons, and even do some substantive more analysis if you actually develop a proper dictionary where you validate that these terms make a lot of sense.